very happy to welcome Professor Sarnam Singh, the speaker for this webinar, a course of remote sensing technology, and all the participants from 33 different countries. This is the sixth talk in this series, and today's topic is remote sensing applications in forest inventory. In all these talks, there has been very good questions by the participants, and Professor Sarnam Singh has taken effort to answer most of them. But in case any of the participants have any question that he or she has not asked or still have doubt on any of the talks that we have had in the past, and we will have two more after today's talk. So in the last day, Professor Sarnam Singh have agreed that he will give more time to the discussion on the questions. So please, whatever doubts you have, please raise on that day, the last day, that is eighth talk of this series. And before I hand over the mic to Professor Sarnam Singh, though it is his sixth talk, and you all very well know him and his work and the way he has been presenting the talks, and we all have been benefited by that. But just for the sake of completeness, I'll say very few words about Professor Sarnam Singh. Professor Sarnam Singh is a PhD in botany, and at the moment he is a senior professor and dean at Nalanda University, an international university and a ancient place of learning in India. Before joining this university, he has worked at two premier institutions in India, the Botanical Survey of India and Indian Institute of Remote Sensing, which is at Dehradun in India. At this institute, Institute for Remote Sensing, he has done extremely good work as a faculty of that institute, as a head of the division, as a group director, and dean of the center. At this institute, there is also a Center for Space Science and Technology Education for Asia Pacific region, and he has been associated with that for quite a long time as a faculty, as a program coordinator, as a course director of remote sensing and GIS, and also the director in charge. And he has taught students from 94 countries under that program. He is a discoverer of many plant species, and he is an ardent explorer by nature. He has published more than 100 scientific research papers and authored or co-authored 25 books. In 14 books, he has written chapters. With these few words, I now invite Professor Sarnam Singh
for the sixth talk, and I would like also to thank Professor Vans for introducing me again. Today's talk is basically to talk about the application of remote sensing in forest inventory. Forests are found in almost every country, and they are the very important part of the ecosystem. And it is very important to know what we have and what can be done so that we are updated as far as the application and the use of the space technology for forest inventory. Today we will discuss about the topic, that is the forest inventory. We'll look first on the definitions and little bit of introduction, why it is important to do all these activities, and then how we should plan, because forest inventory is a big exercise. Proper planning is required. There are different steps, so we just look into that. And then we should, first thing is to do the mapping, the land use, land cover mapping, or vegetation cover or density type mapping. All this is required. Then we'll also discuss about the sampling design. This is one of the most important things which remote sensing helps us in designing the sampling and finding out the areas, and all that can be done using satellite data. Then how should we collect the field data? That's very important. And then how we should organize the data and try to analyze it. At the end, we'll see how the satellite data can be used for modeling, because spectral modeling is very important aspect. Whatever plot information or pixel information we may have, we need to convert into a larger area. And that is possible through what we call geospatial modeling or spectral modeling. Growing stock is an important activity for all kinds of forest management and decision making process, particularly in the production forestry. It is very important for any country to know how much of the timber or wood is available in the forest, how much can be harvested, how can we plan for the future requirements, maybe 20, 30 or 100 years. So that's why forest inventory is a very important activity of the forest management. Therefore, it is important to know how much stock that is available per unit area, and then we can think about how to improve and how to harvest sustainably. So that's a very important aspect. Again, we talk about the in forest inventory. If you look back in earlier days, this kind of activity used to be carried out using site quality maps, and we used to have a chain, and then we used to go to the field and do the measurements. It used to be very exhaustive exercise, used to take a lot of time, because area of any forest or any vegetation is required for any kind of assessment or analysis. So now remote sensing helps us to do the delineation, so we don't have to really go to the field. And therefore, regular assessment, now remote sensing is available to us. So regular assessment of stock, wood volume, harvestable timber available today or in the coming years is important. Similarly, nowadays we are all talking about the climate change. So for every country now, it is important to know how much of the biomass or carbon is available in the vegetation, whether natural vegetation or in plantations or trees outside forest. So that's very important aspect. A lot of emphasis is given in India also to study these scattered or natural forest. Most of the countries are also committed to give this kind of information to UNFCCC, and there is a communication that's called NATCOM, and to just inform how much of vegetation carbon pool is available at a given time, and each country is supposed to share that information. Let me also tell you that forest is a very important component of this ecosystem, and approximately 50% of the global greenhouse gas mitigation is possible, because the plants absorb the CO2, atmosphere CO2, and make food and store in the form of wood, and approximately 50% of that is carbon. So you can say if you destroy or burn any wood or anything, you are releasing a lot of CO2 into the air, but if trees are absorbing it, that means there is a possibility that 50% of the biomass which they are containing has the carbon. About 30 million acres of tropical rainforest is destroyed every year. This is a very alarming situation. Thus, globally, deforestation accounts for almost 20% of the greenhouse gas emissions, or about 5.8 billion tons of CO2 is at least in the atmosphere, which is a very alarming figure. This is more than, this is really disheartening, because this is more than global transport or aviation combined together due to burning of the fossil and the other sources. So if we are trying to destroy a forest, that means we are doing more harm, in fact, than doing the fossil fuel burning. So protection of these, growing of the forest, all this is very important. There is another thing here: the area under production forestry is increasing by 2.2 million hectares per annum, because a lot of area, natural forest area, has been removed. They wanted to extract a lot of timber, And that's how all those areas are now people doing the, or countries are doing plantations. But the demand for timber is increasing because more and more people are able to afford. So, I mean, this is very important that we should have enough of these resources available for the utilization by people. So let us start with the definitions part of, so let us say botanically, what is a forest? Because we are talking forest inventory. So let us understand what is a forest. In the very simplest language, we can say forest is in a vegetated area or a type of vegetation dominated by trees. You will find several definitions in the literature. Yes, they are all right. The context could be different, but just to understand in today's present context, this would be sufficient to understand this is a basically a type of vegetation which has tall trees. And the inventory of the forest deals with generating information on trees. The girth class distribution, that means whether they are only very high girth class, middle girth class, or they have also small girth class distribution. How much of timber is available? What is the age class distribution? Because this is very important. If you do not have young trees or young plants growing in the forest, that means your regeneration is poor. And in after 30, 40, or 100 years, you probably may not have these plants because there is no regeneration happening. So it is very important that we study what is the regeneration, what is the age class distribution. And also to understand all these things, the study of site conditions, the growth pattern, the timber quality, how much revenue government is going to earn, and how it helps in watershed management and biodiversity conservation. So if you put together all these basically help to manage the forest in much, much better way. That's why inventory is a very important part of it. If you have to say what is a growing stock, it's basically sum, either by number or by volume, of all the trees growing in the forest, or a specified part of it at a specified time. So when we, if we say, let us say today, this much of carbon pool or biomass is present, that is valid for tomorrow, today, because tomorrow if somebody removes something, then it becomes difficult that it might reduce. So we should not consider that part here. We can say the growing stock is a living tree component of the standing volume. This is a very statement that means basically quantity of the standing timber. We don't talk about the dead timber. Whenever we do growing stock assessment, we talk about the plants which are alive and they are growing. And we can say numerically also, they are very important for forest management planning, decision making, and for all departments, they work on this to prepare a working plan or management plan or the stock map of the area. You can express this in the cubic per meter or per cubic feet also, any of these you can use. And the next term which I will be discussing later part of it, the biomass or phytomass. Phyto means basically plant, mass means the weight, let us say in layman's language. So if I have to define biomass, I can say biomass is an oven dry weight of living organism. And let us say in case of trees, we have a total weight of a living, let us say tree or plant, and if you dry it in an oven at 80 degrees Celsius for maybe 2 or 3 days, all the water will be evaporated. Whatever is left is the dry weight. That is called the biomass. Of that, nearly 35 to 52% is the carbon. So if we assess the biomass, it is possible to convert that value into the carbon. So that's not a big issue. So I just wanted to show you some pictures of the food. You can see here, this is a teak plantation, this is eucalyptus plantation, so there are production forestry. This is a natural forest of Southern Era, very high density forest. Down you can see sal forest, okay. This is a moist deciduous forest, and then we have the pine forest, and then deciduous mixed forest. So you can see the, in terms of the diameter of the trees, or in terms of the height of the trees, they are all different. So it is possible to do the inventory and find out how much of biomass or growing stock is present. So just to give you an idea about how the forest looks like. Why we should be doing this thing? It is very important. First thing is to determine the basal area. Basal area is the basically, we have a bole. Bole has certain diameter. And if you project that diameter on the, let us say, on the surface soil, that you can call it basal area. Higher the basal area, that means the quality of the timber is good, the availability of the timber is good. So we can find out the basal area, the timber volume, the biomass, the carbon, the growth and yield. So everything will be part of the growing stock. We will also see how there are yield tables available. So you can, if you have this diameter class today, maybe after 30 or 40 or 100 years, this will grow and this much of wood will be available. That kind of prediction can be carried out. We can also do the growing stock so that we know how much of can be harvested. That's very important. So suppose in next 5 years or next 10 years, how much of wood can be harvested. So we need to have some inventory. We know the girth class distribution, and then we know, okay, if this is the girth class of this particular tree or this species, then probably we can harvest it. This is also very important for sustainable management. This also helps to justify the forest management. And then of course you can generate a lot of revenue, which goes to the government. And there is a possibility to do a lot of research as far as forest conservation and management is concerned. And then we can plan for the future, because demand and supply is very important. Most of the countries will look for the timber for day-to-day requirement, but it is very important that we should have our own resource, let us say in most of the countries where this kind of is not available, they have to pay heavily and buy this timber from outside. So it costs to the exchequer of it. Let us go a little ahead of it. So stock taking in a given forest area is not only to include measuring or estimating what is present, but little more than that is also required. It basically focuses on the forest plantations as well as natural planted forests. So we cover the both in the inventory. We do the prediction and determination of the forest productivity, which is very important for management. And we also talk about the future harvestable timber availability in 10, 20, 30, 50 years to come in the future. And most important is the age and girth class distribution, because this is what is are we going to basically see what will be the future of a forest which you are managing. So annual increment we can find out if you have at interval measurements, and then we can find out at what stage it is possible to harvest, and then what kind of ecological monitoring is required to assess these things. In natural ecosystems, that means future of the forest structure is also very important. As I said earlier, if we do not have young generation or young plants, that means if you destroy that forest or cut that forest, maybe the entire nature of that forest will change maybe in the coming 20 or 30 years. I'll give you some examples. If you happen to go to Andaman and Nicobar Islands in India, let us say, it is basically should have a tropical evergreen forest, but for some reasons or other, the wood has been extracted and trees have been removed. And then what is coming up, the new succession or secondary succession is basically of the dry deciduous species. So the basic nature, that means from tropical evergreen forest is now becoming tropical dry deciduous forest. So this can happen. Therefore, it is very important to know and how to manage. So what will be the yield? What are the ecological conditions? What should be the harvesting pattern are to be studied. We can also find out the composition of the forest, because if you talk about the merchantable timber, because that's very important, and we can also do, and that's a very important part of the forest management. Just touch upon the IPCC and Kyoto Protocol in that, where the basic requirement each government is supposed to inform. So first thing is to know what is the carbon stock in each country, so inventory becomes very important. Second is the, what is the potential carbon sequestration of different forest type or site conditions. Let us say India has roughly 221 types and subtypes of the forest. So what is the potential of carbon sequestration? Let us say evergreen forest, dry deciduous forest, moss deciduous forest, or conifer forest, or let us say temperate forest. It's very important to know, and what is the area and then how much can be sequestered. This is these are the study research questions we have to answer. So the whole idea is to mitigate the carbon from the atmosphere and remove it, and then mitigate the climate change, which is may impact heavily the life on this planet. So let us go to the steps. How do we do the planning part of it? So first thing is the objective. We need to define very clearly what kind of information is required for fresh or updated. So if you have already done something, then we probably need to revise those maps and information. If not done, we can generate fresh information. How much time, how much money and manpower is available? So if you have enough manpower, then of course it's not a big issue, but normally we'll have constraints in this aspect. So time, funds and manpower accordingly, and the field condition. After we have decided how much time and funds are available, we need to standardize the how should we go about. So what are the requirements, what kind of tables and recommendations are required, we can do it. And after that, we should do the sampling design, because where we should lay the plots, that's very important. I will be touching upon the how to remote sensing can help you to do the sampling design and find out where to lay sample plots. And then we can also decide on what kind of parameters are to be observed. Let us say here DBH means diameter at breast height, height of the trees and crown of the trees. So I'm just giving some examples, but much more information is normally collected when we visit field. So diameter, density, dominant species, form factor, rock outcrop, stoniness, site conditions, all can be noted down. They are very useful when we try to do the extrapolation of this information, that how much area is covered by real trees and how much area is covered by rocks. So we can exactly find out the area under green cover, and accordingly we can calculate the area as well as the carbon or biomass or the timber available in that particular area. And we will be using aerospace data, very high resolution satellite data for this kind of an activity. Then comes the distribution class for tree height and timber volume. This is age class distribution is required. So we will have to collect this kind of information from the field. We have to convert this information into the beat wise, compartment wise, range wise, division wise. These are the management units of the forest departments. So how much timber is available in each beat, each compartment, that is one of the objectives of the inventory. So we can do using the methodology. And then how much is the growth? That means what is the annual increment in the timber? And then how much is being extracted? That means draining. People extract for fuel wood, illegal cutting of the forest or trees, maybe some pest or maybe damage due to the cyclone. So we should know what is the rate of increment as well as how much of wood is being extracted. So then we can find out the balance. And then unit-wise harvestable timber, unit-wise timber availability for the future. And then also we can have ecological observations for the future of the forest, because this is also a very important aspect. We only should not enjoy the benefits of the forest today, but we should leave something for the future generations. And once we have all that done, then we go to the field and I have the data collected, and then try to relate and develop relationship between different kinds of the parameters. Say for example, I have given some examples here. That means diameter and breast height versus volume, height versus diameter, crown versus diameter, leaf area index. LAI is basically leaf area index versus volume. We probably, when you go to the literature, you'll find these are very important biophysical parameters which can be, you know, noted, and some kind of relationship is established. And then this relationship will be trying to establish with the satellite data and try to do some kind of geospatial modeling. So just to summarize, what is the methodology? So first thing is to have the satellite data. Second thing comes the sampling design. So if I have the map, I can do the sampling design. So forest type map is required, density map is required, normalized difference vegetation is required, accessibility, whether it is accessible or not, and district boundary, because we would like to do the inventory for each district. So nothing is left out. And then we can lay out the super plots, that means in homogeneous strata that we can find out from the satellite data. And we can do the either one plot or we can have cluster of plots in certain area. Create a database in MXL or any spreadsheet, that's not a problem. And then volume equations and specific gravity. These are the two very important things we need to understand. Volume equations are available. For most of the commercial species, volume equations are available. They are basically simple linear equations. And if you know the DBH, if you can just put the DBH as an independent variable, you will get the volume of that particular tree. So this is one way to get the volume of a tree. Once we get the volume of the tree, that's the growing stock, I can multiply with the specific gravity, that's the basically wood density of that particular species. We can convert this volume into biomass. Once we have converted the timber into biomass, then we can multiply with 0.47. This is an average value normally people take. And then we can find out how much of carbon is available in particular forest or particular tree or particular species. So this is the overall view of how the steps we take up to do the forest inventory. But there will be many more in between things to do where some expertise is required. So first thing, as I said, remote sensing data. So let us say I have a remote sensing data here, and I have already discussed you how to do the supervised and unsupervised classification. So let us say I have given you here some annotations, different types of the forest. So let us say we have a map prepared out of this. So let us say this is the map I have, and then I can use this map for what we call the stratification, because already we have now strata. Here strata means each forest type, like sal is one strata, sal in Melotus philippensis can be one, Lantana camara can be other, Sizeium cubani can be other, dry deciduous is different. So each of the legend is basically a strata. So we know the area of it, we know the what type of forest are present in that, and then we can start working on the sampling design. So sampling design is most important part, and this has to be done scientifically. It should not be just based on that, okay, random or very objective, unless inventory. So once we have the objective defined, time and money available to us, and the number of persons, we can find out the satellite images or aerial photographs, and then try to follow any of these methods. I will be focusing mostly on the stratified random sampling. But there are three methods to do that. One is the systematic sampling, where people do the grids overlay on the map, and then they choose whether to select all the grids or one grid. They, within a grid, they can do random sampling, or we can use stratified random sampling. Strata means which comes from remote sensing, each forest type or each land use and land cover. And within that, we can do some kind of a randomization. So that is the very important aspect of it. So I'll just focus more on the stratified random sampling, because this saves a lot of time. Remote sensing provides a lot of information to us, where to go, where to lay sample plots, how far it is from the road, and a lot of time and lot of time, money and manpower is saved. Another thing is that we will be going to lay the sample plots in homogeneous areas. This is also very important, because if you have a mix of the forest type, then your into entry is going to be having some kind of errors introduced in it. So normally we prefer what we call the stratified random sampling based on homogeneity maps, and that's called the probability proportion to its size. That means, let us say you have decided to take X number of sample plots or X number of area to be sampled, and based on the area, we can, let us say we have 4 or 5 classes, and then depending on the area, we can proportionately distribute the sample plots to be taken in each forest type or in each category. So that's called the probability proportion to its size. So now let us say this is an image. Just quickly I will tell you, this is an image of Boone Valley basically. So all this red is basically sal forest. This is a dry deciduous forest. This is a moist forest. Okay. If you go on the hills, you will find this oak forest here. And then this all pink is all agriculture. This is a river Yamuna. This is a river Ganges. Okay. And this all is sal forest. So this is roughly how a scene looks like. So I can prepare a roughly good map. So I can say, okay, this dark green color is a sal, and this next light green color is a dry deciduous forest. So we can have this kind of map prepared using satellite data. We can overlay grid. Let us say I have taken a grid of some dimension. You can have 1 kilometer, 1 kilometer, or 2.5 kilometer by 2.5 kilometer. It's up to you. If you have more money, you can take a smaller grid size. So let us say I have now a type map, and on that type map, I can put this grid. And then on this grid, I would like to find out how I can go about. So let us say if I take let us say this is one grid, and I can, that red area indicates that this is my area where I'm going to do the sampling. So I can take each grid, I can take one sampling. This is called systematic sampling. That means I'm not leaving any grid, but it takes a lot of time, lot of repetition, lot of redundancy in the data. I can modify a little bit this thing. I can do instead of taking in each grid, I can take in any alternative. Let's say I can take one here, I can take here, like that I can do. So I leave one Y. That way I can reduce the expenditure and save on some time. We can follow many methods are there. So let this, we can leave two grids. So I can leave this grid, I can leave this, and I can follow on this. So you can take every third grid. There are a lot of variations are possible. Now within the grid, you can again do some kind of a, you know, strategy you can follow. Let us say within the grid, you can do randomization. So you can choose any of these. So for example, I can take here, I can take here, anywhere. So that's also a kind of randomization. And the better way of doing is that we can divide that grid to further into subgrids, and within subgrids we can decide, okay, I will do sampling in this grid. It's up to you to decide, actually, depending upon requirement. Each of these methods has its own advantages and disadvantages. Okay, so then we can do this. This is based, now I'm not talking about the systematic sampling. So now I'm talking about the stratified random sampling. And if I have to do a single plot, let us say these are the locations of single plot. So I'm not talking about now agriculture. This yellow color is agriculture. So I'm not wasting my time and going and wasting to lay sample plots. No, I straightway go to the forest areas. Now let us say these, wherever you find these red square dots are forested areas. So I will now focus only for my inventory in these areas. So this way you save a lot of money and time, and all the classes are covered. You are not going to leave any of these classes. So that's the advantage of the remote sensing. Now there are methods to, automatic methods are available to prepare homogeneity map. So we can have a homogeneity map based on the density as well as based on the forest type. We can overlay type and density map in GIS and can prepare a homogeneity map. That means each strata will have one particular density and one particular forest type. And that also helps in to do the sampling. So you can see here, if I have very high density forest here, I have 60 to 80% density, 40 to 60%, little less, and less than 20%. You can have all kinds of situations in that particular area. Next question comes, let us say I have now a homogeneity map, and on that I cannot lay out how many plots I am supposed to take. So I can randomly, I can put, let's say I want to do sampling here, I want to do the sampling, all these small dots which you can see on a screen, these are the locations predefined before going to the field that I will take the sampling. So they're very much randomized, and each strata is covered, each area is covered. So that is the most important and beauty of remote sensing, that we can do randomization so that we have best sites and worst sites, everything covered during the sampling. So let us say once we have decided the number of sample plots to be taken, next step becomes the what should be the my plot size. So there is a difference between sample size and the plot size. Sample size is the basic number of samples. And the plot size is the size of the plot, means 5 by 5 meter or 10 by 10 meter or 30 by 30 meter. And there is a process called species area curve. So if you can follow the species area curve and plot it, wherever the curve flattens, let us say in this case somewhere it flattens here, so we can draw the perpendicular and vertical here, and then we can find out what is the area. So let us say in this example around 26 or 27 by 27 meter will be the ideal size for laying a plot. We can have different types of the plot designs. We can have the squares here, we can have the circular plots here, or we can have the transect. It all depends where you are comfortable. So we can do any of these. The most important is that area should be covered so that we don't have to really bother about the what we call the loss of the data. And then of course, this is the way that we can take measurements. So diameter of the has to be taken around 1.37 meters above the girth, okay, from the surface, I mean. So this is the, so we take the diameter here at this level. That's how the person is doing here. This is very important to observe. So there are many methods to do it, but that's how the data, and you can use the what you call metallic tape so that it doesn't tear and torn off very quickly. What kind of measurements have to be taken in the field? First is the total tree height is very important aspect. Is we can also do the merchantable height, because it is not that entire tree is has the commercial value. So anything which is less than 20 centimeter dia may not be very useful. This will be depending upon the requirement. We can, if you are only interested in the clean bowl height, we can do that also. Or if you are interested in the commercial bowl height, that also. There are different options available. We can, depending upon the requirement, we can take the measurements so that you know, you can accordingly find out what kind of. This is just to tell you how the tee height. There is an instrument called hypsometer we can use. Or there is an instrument called dendrometer we can use to find out the height of the trees. Requires a little bit of training. So this is the hypsometer. This is a dendrometer. There are many other instruments also available like hypsometer, clinometer, altimeter, dendrometer, laser cut. There are different types of instruments are available to find out the tree height. Depends upon the what you have. Now once I have the measurements done from the field, then next thing comes to find out the volume of it. So if you go to the literature, you'll find the volume equations, and these volume equations are very species specific. That's what I've written here. Like if you have a volume equation for tree, let us say teak tree, that cannot be used for pine or sal tree or vice versa. So the first choice, what we say in MT, is the to use species specific and area specific. This also happens because the site conditions and climatic conditions and rate of growth of the trees is different in different parts of the any country. So it is always better to choose same species and same area equation. If it is not available, then of course there are a lot of options here. We normally say take a region specific equation, or if it is not available, then say okay, each state may have a general equation. We call it, you can take general equation. If not, within that genus, you can have a equation. This is something which is very tricky, but yes, we have to somehow manage. If nothing is available, there is this quadrant girth formula, we call it. If you can apply, so girth is known to you, just find out what is the length of the pole and you can find out what is the volume. So this is a very simple linear equation is used. You have the dependent variable and then you have the independent variable, that is the diameter, height or crown, anything can be used. And there can be any combinations which are here. So let us say once I have done this thing, I can find out the basal area of it and then try to establish the relationship between the basal area and the volume. And if you get this kind of a curve, that means your data is error free, and then that means you can further proceed. If you find this kind of zigzag here and there, that means some problem with the data, it has to be corrected. Now we can convert this tree volume into biomass by multiplying the specific rate, as I told earlier. And first we will do for each tree, and then we sum up for each tree, it becomes a plot level biomass. The plot level biomass has to be converted to pixel level biomass because we are talking about the satellite data, and satellite data has to be used for modeling. So we need to convert this thing into that one. Okay, so let us go ahead now. We talk about the spectral modeling. We have discussed little bit of the, let us say, NDVI and enhanced vegetation indices. There are several types of the indices which are available. You can also do the even normal spectral band, let us say red, infrared or green or middle infrared, but any of these. The basic idea is to choose any of the bands or combination of bands or derived parameter to correlate with the pixel biomass. So I have the, from plot biomass, I have converted into pixel biomass. I know the GPS location of that. So I know the pixel, that this is the biomass of this pixel, and this is the red value, infrared value, DN value, or this is the NDVI or EVI value. Then I can establish a relationship between these parameters. So that means you have a complete data set now ready. So this is called basically spectral modeling. This is to extrapolate point or pixel to entire area, because sampling is for a site, a small area. If I have to extrapolate to the remaining area or larger area, we need to have some kind of relationship established, and then we can convert that into an area which will depict different types of the biomass or carbon or whatever the parameter you are trying to observe. You can do the geospatial modeling and find out the spatial distribution of that particular parameter. So once we have the created database, let us say in any spreadsheet, you can use SPSS, Statistica or MS Excel to start with. Establish correlation between the pixel biomass and the distal number. Okay, I mean, we can convert it to radians also. This once you have established the relationship between pixel and the biomass, so you get an equation. And there will be many methods to do that. Sometimes you may not get very good relationship with the linear. You can try logarithmic function, you can try power function, you can try exponential functions. So there are a lot of opportunities for you. Once you have a database, then you can play around with the data and you can try to use different functions. That's what I've just mentioned about four functions here. Another thing is the proper season data selection. That's very important part of it. If we take dry season data, that means in dry season you may not have leaves, and that means there will be no absorption and no reflectance. So this, that means you are going to get a maybe an inverse relationship here. But if you have a good green cover, maybe you get a positive relationship. It doesn't matter whether you get the negative or positive relationship. We should get, try to get good coefficient of determination. That's the important. R square value, whether negative or positive is made, that for us it is an absolute value basically. So that's not an issue. The idea is that we should try to establish a relationship which can give you very reliable information when we do the geospatial modeling. So we can do all these things and then we can try to do the modeling. This is just to show you the what is the relationship between the above ground biomass of trees, okay, tons, that means plot biomass tons per hectare, and the basal area. It is normally supposed to have one-to-one relationship, so you can expect a very high R square value, let us say 0.9 here, maybe better than also. This is always released, more the basal area, more the biomass. This is one-to-one relationship, so that's not a big deal actually. But more important is that how do the spectral model. So let us see here, I have now got a good band. This is an example here. I have taken the red band and I have taken the biomass tons per hectare. You can choose any band. I'm just giving an example of red band. You can take infrared band, middle infrared band, and try to establish relationship with the biomass, and you can get some kind of R square value. So let us say in this case example, I am getting an R square value of 0.78, which is reasonably good. That means I can now try to do the extrapolation and try to establish relationship and do the geospatial modeling. So let us see, this example shows you that I have now taken data. I have used four functions: linear, logarithmic, power, and exponential. And what kind of data set I have? I have February NDVI, March NDVI, May NDVI, October NDVI, you know, all this I am having: November, December, February, March. So I am now trying to collect, do the spectral modeling with all the data set which I have. Maybe annual, you may have 12 months data with you. Maybe you get a very good relationship with one data set. So that is very important. So let us say I am getting very good relationship here. That is the October red band data. So, I mean, it all depends which area you are working, what type of forest you are handling. Suppose you are having evergreen forest, you may get very good relationship with the infrared band. If you are handling dry deciduous forest, you may get with the red band. It's all area specific. Only I can suggest is please try several of these models and several season data. Don't only just depend on one. That's one thing. Second thing is sometimes you don't get good relationship with one type of the satellite data. So you can try other type of data sets also, because this is limited that I have to use only this satellite data or that satellite data. You can choose from the any satellite data which is available to us. So once I have fixed, okay, this is the best R square value, let us say I'm getting here, and then I go for the modeling. So this is, I can now find out that I am getting the best relationship between the predicted and the estimated carbon. Here I'm giving an example. I have now converted the biomass into carbon by multiplying with the 0.47. So the value becomes almost half, and but relationship remains the same. So then I can say, okay, what is the relationship between the estimated, that means from the ground-based observations, and predicted based on the geospatial modeling. So that is the kind of relationship, that means the confidence level is all right, because it's after a satellite data. This is the relationship which I have got. This is supposed to be the best relationship for that area. And then I apply this equation, that is y is equal to 0.009x minus 0.3135. So x is, in this case, is my, let's say, NDVI, and then I can prepare. So I have a NDVI map on that NDVI map. I run this equation. I put the IR or NDVI, whatever the parameter you have found the best for your area, as a independent variable in the equation, and just press enter, run the model. You will get this kind of map for that area. Now this is a basically a map of part of Gujarat in the Surat in and around. So it is possible for us to have some data. So in fact, we had done the sampling only this part, and we tried to establish the relationship, but we were able to extrapolate this information in much larger area without doing sampling. So that is the advantage of remote sensing. So I have done sampling only this part, but I use that to extrapolate that point information, because the similar forest type occurs, similar conditions occur in additional extra or maybe adjacent areas. So I can do. So this is the advantage of geospatial modeling. Once I have taken the some data for some area, establish a relationship, I can use that relationship for a larger area. That's the beauty of the remote sensing. I think this is the end of my talk today. These are some of the references. Maybe there are latest publications where we have used the ground data and try to establish the relationship with the biomass, and then try to find out what is the biomass or carbon available in that particular area. So now we move to the question answer session. There is a question here, but what is the role of specific gravity in methodology in forest growing? That's a good question. See, if I have to convert this growing stock into carbon, I need to have the density. That means the density of the wood, how heavy that it is. So specific gravity is basically that. Growing stock in general sense, you can say the timber available, but how heavy that timber is, what is the weight of it? That is important. And weight is directly related to the carbon present in the specific gravity or wood density, whatever you want to understand, the way you want to understand. And that's how we can convert growing stock into a carbon value of that area. Okay, this is a question from Shashank. He says, I did not understand what that exactly. How can we calculate the carbon quantity in a particular forest by electronic images? That's a very good and interesting question. I would like to elaborate. I think I have time to do that. If you remember, I don't know, many of you recall that we have talked about the spectral signature. We have also discussed about the reflectance in different regions of the solar spectrum, electromagnetic spectrum. And if you recall your the past lectures, you will see here, we had around 15% reflectance in green region, around 8% in red, and we had around 50 to 60% in the infrared region. Now, infrared region becomes very important. So that means it is indication of many things. Infrared is a region where you can find out the vigor of that. Even it is used for quantification of that wood or whatever is available. Let me again repeat for you. See, first thing what we are doing is trying to find out the volume of tree within a one plot. Let us say you have a plot of 30 meter by 30 meter. This is an example I'm giving you. Within this, let us say you have found some cubic meters of volume, wood volume. I can now convert this into biomass. So I can multiply by the specific gravity. So now I get the biomass of that. If I multiply by this biomass for that plot by 0.47, roughly let us say, I can convert into the carbon. So that is first step is over. Second step is, now each pixel, because I am using a GPS, I know in which pixel, which area I have done the sampling. Let us say I know X and Y of that area. I know the biomass of that particular XY area or that pixel. I know the digital number of that pixel in red, green, infrared, or in NDVI value of same pixel where you have laid the sample plot. So I have now two information available with me. I know the per pixel biomass of that area, and I know the per pixel DN value or NDVI value or any other parameter of the same area. So now I can try to establish relationship. And if you remember, NDVI is used for quantification of the vegetation. So once you establish the relationship between the per pixel biomass and the value, DN value or NDVI value. The higher the NDVI, more is the vegetation carbon in that. So that's how you can correlate and you get an equation. So this is very much doable. Maybe you can again look into some more literature, Mr. Sasan, then you will understand. Because electronic means it is a number, and that number depends upon the vigor of the forest. If it is more vigor, that means more number. That means more, you can say, biomass. And that's how it gets correlated and you can use for further extrapolation. There is a question from Adya Shukla. Can we estimate average age of the forest using technology without going to the on ground level? Let me tell you, Mr. Shukla, this technology is basically normally used for mapping. That's the first thing, find out the area. Second, your question is very good in the sense because height of the tree is also very important to us. So let us say if you have a digital elevation model, or if you have a data which has stereo pair data, we call it, we can find out the height of it. Yes, you can use the satellite data, let's say aerial photographs particularly. So there is a methodology called photogrammetry. So if you have two overlapping areas and you have a digital elevation model, digital terrain model, digital surface model, then it is possible to find out the height of the trees, first thing. Now, if you know the rate of growth of the trees, let us say a particular, let us say sal, in 10 years it will grow, let us say 4 meters. In 20 years it will grow 6 meters. In 30 years it will grow 10 meters. If you know the rate of growth of tree, you can get some idea that this will be the age of this forest. That's one thing. It is not always true, my dear, because site conditions, what is the quality of the soil? If it is a good soil, you will have rate of growth higher. If it is a very rocky area, bouldery area, rate of growth will be less. So you will get an erroneous result. So the best way is to go to the ground, take the measurements, and then correlate with the satellite data. It's possible. We have done it. We get an accuracy of approximately 1 to 2 meter difference in the actual and the predicted value. Ismail, you are asking a question, how can I download? What I really don't know what you want to download. Maybe you can ask specifically what you would like to download. Maybe we can help you. Okay, please ask the organizers how to download this video. I think Professor Vass will be able to answer this question. There is a question from Basam Dahi. Can the allometric equation use only age, only as field variables to predict AGB? No. Age is not always the criteria because see what happens, no? In the initial stage of the any tree or any plant or any human being for that matter, we grow very fast. And in our height also, let us say at the age of 20, 21 year with each, and then height doesn't increase, but weight keeps on increasing. So there is no one-to-one relationship. Even in trees also can attain, let us say, 20, 30 meter or 40 meter height, depending upon the species. But girth can keep on increasing. Height may not increase, girth can increase. So age is not that important. What is important is for such kind of measurements, the diameter of the tree. You can have a stunted growth, but you can have a huge diameter. That means a lot of wood is available. So please don't give more emphasis to the age. What is more important is for the diameter and the tree height of that. And that will give you very good information about the above ground biomass. Jisan, you are asking how can we reduce deforestation? This is the question. Of course, we have been trying to find an answer. The best thing is, let us not depend on the forest. So our dependency on forest should decrease. That means we should not be using too much of the forest products. If we do that, then it is possible the demand will decrease, deforestation will also decrease. And the thing is, we need more agriculture area because of the population pressure. So this is also one of the things, the population has to be controlled, because otherwise we'll have to, there's no end to it. We will keep on demanding more and more area for cultivation. Mr. Basam Dahi, any specific recommendation regarding estimating AGB and carbon on arid and semi-arid land? Let me tell you, all the friends who are participating in this webinar or listening to us, that methodology remains the same. You can work in any area. you can work, you choose any satellite data, you can choose any season, but our objective is to get good relationship. That means I need to be a little bit proactive and try to get best satellite data so that I can establish good relationship. You can work in arid region, you can get tropical region, subtropical, work in whatever forest type you are working, that's not an issue. Methodology remains the same. There is Bharat who is asking, please suggest the tutorial from where I can learn forest change study with a specific software using RS. You can choose any RS data and you can choose any software, that's not an issue. So basically, is that you want to do the change detection. So if you remember in yesterday lecture I had told, if you are doing digital change detection method, then please ensure that your satellite data which you are going to choose is of same sensor, that means same spatial resolution and same spectral resolution also. Otherwise there are chances that errors will creep in. So same season, same sensor data, you can use any of the methods which I have discussed yesterday. You can take NDVI, you can say image subtraction, you can do post classification comparison, you can do principal component analysis, you can do image differencing. There are many methods which are available. That's not an issue. Most important is that your satellite data should be of same sensor and same season. Because if you take one of growing season, one of dry season, and you will find in dry season, lot of the vegetation is showing no, I know, reflectance. It is not a red color. Indicates that it's, everything has changed. No, it is not. So phenology is very important. So same phenological stage, please download the data and you can do the good. To start with, I would suggest to you, if you take download two or three data sets, maybe you just run, you stack all these layers, maybe use any software. Let us say you have four bands or six bands from one satellite. So you get 4 + 4 = 8 or 6 + 6 = 12 bands. And then you run the principal component analysis just to start with, to understand. And you make some, let us say 12 means 12 principal components you can prepare. And just see after first three, you will find very interesting observation. There will be some areas which are black in color. There will be some areas which are white in color. These are the areas where changes have occurred, whether it is negative or positive, that you have to establish. So if the deforestation has occurred, it will be black in color. If it is afforestation, maybe growth has taken place, something has been added, maybe it can appear in white in color. But you can have different tones of it. I'm just giving an example. It may not be always true, depending upon the case to case, because principal component analysis, you need to understand what it's basically doing. But this is to start with. Next is you can prepare two maps. Let us say time one map, time two map. Maybe visual interpretation, if you are not good in the image classification, you do some visual interpretation of time one and time two. So you take time one interpreted map, overlay on the time two. So now please try to understand. You have a time one map, let us say vector layer, on a Mylar sheet or transparent sheet, or set maybe computer also, overlay that vector map on a next maybe time two data, you will find there is a change in the boundary. So what you have to do is you have to go and edit those boundaries. So wherever changes are there, you do the redigitization, edit those boundaries. So then first map and second map, you can do the subtraction. So you can get the result, what changes have happened. There are many methods to do it. Probably once you start doing, you will understand the significance of each one. Okay, if there are no questions, maybe we'll try to stop here. Yeah, I don't find any question, which is rest is all hello and good morning. Fine, friends, so we'll stop here. Thank you very much for attending. Tomorrow we will discuss about the how remote sensing and GIS can be used for biodiversity characterization. This is also one of the very important topics these days, and there's a lot of role remote sensing and GIS can play. So bye for now. We will meet tomorrow. Thank you very much.